The following is a presentation of Be Well, a multiple media health information project presented by WVIZ-PBS, Ideastream. Funding comes from the Dr. Donald J. Goodman and Ruth Weber Goodman Philanthropic Fund of the Cleveland Foundation, the Margaret Clark Morgan Foundation, the McGregor Foundation, the Woodruff Foundation, and the Community Foundation of Lorain County.
The rate of severe obesity in the United States has skyrocketed over the last decade.
Fast food is a large part of our culture. It's our lifestyle. If you don't turn it around, you're going to be obese and overweight.
We are literally eating ourselves to death.
I couldn't get around.
My family had to do everything for me. I couldn't even tie my own shoes.
And I'm almost 50 years old, and I got to look at, where do I want to be? And I'm thinking, man, I got to lose some weight. And that's kind of what was my wake-up call.
We've lost focus in this country of what a normal weight looks and feels like.
It boils down to saving money. Obesity is an expensive disease.
Part of the obesity epidemic is that we need healthy food. We need access to it.
Kids in this neighborhood are not eating as well as they should. They're eating a whole lot of junk food.
The diet started sliding. The fast food started creeping in. The physical activity became less, and I was a mess. I had 6 of the 8 risks for stroke and heart attack staring at me in the face.
There is no doubt about it. Things are getting bigger. The patient weight limit for ambulances, for instance, used to be 800 pounds. Now, ambulances can accommodate patients who weigh 1,000 pounds or more. CT scanners used to have a 60-centimeter opening. These days, they are 80 centimeters wide. A standard-sized casket used to be 24 inches wide, but today, 29-inch wide caskets are in high demand. Hello, I'm Rick Jackson. Things are getting bigger because we are getting bigger. Obesity has become a national epidemic. For the next hour, you'll hear stories from local people who are waging their own personal wars against weight. Plus, we'll talk with experts who will help us to look beyond the bulges to understand the science and medicine of obesity. Why do people gain weight? And what's at stake for all of us if we don't stop this deadly trend? And make no mistake, it is a trend. It started back in the mid-1980s. Back in 1985, the TV show Miami Vice was a big hit on NBC. I was on NBC as well. Here I was hosting the morning show at Channel 3, right here in Cleveland. That was nearly 30 years ago, and yes, I admit, nearly 30 pounds ago. In 1985, there were 8 states where 10% of the population was rated as obese. As you can see, Ohio was one of them. This map, and those that follow, were created by the Centers for Disease Control to track the progression of the obesity epidemic. Now, look what happened in just 5 years. In 1990, the number of states where 10% of the population was obese quadrupled. 5 years later, in 1995, we change color and go to dark blue. That's because in these states, up to 19% of the population was obese. Just 2 years later, in 1997, big trouble. Tan states start appearing. Tan represents 20% or higher prevalence of obesity. By the year 2000, lots of states are tan. Some are turning orange. That color indicates that 25% of the people living in those states were obese. Red states started appearing in 2005. No, these aren't Republican states. These are states where 30% or more of the people were regarded as obese. Finally, in 2010, lots of orange and red. All told, a dozen states with an obesity prevalence of 30% or higher. And things are projected to get a whole lot worse if current trends continue. A new report by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation indicates that by 2030, all 50 states could have obesity rates of 44% or higher, and 1 in 3 adults could have type 2 diabetes. I'm joined now by Dr. Matthew Crow, a surgeon in the Digestive Disease Institute at the Cleveland Clinic. Welcome and thanks for coming in today. Certainly, we want to ask you what happened. Why this dramatic increase?
Well, it's a complex answer, and we don't really have all the answers quite yet. It's an interaction of increased consumption, less physical activity, and probably genetics that we're really just starting to see really the tip of the iceberg with.
And at the same time, you have to wonder, how did we get here? Did we not see this coming?
The answer's not as easy either. The multifactorial nature of this really doesn't give us an answer as to why we're here now. I think there's been significant predictions of this, mm-hmm. but the enormity of it is really becoming more compelling, especially when we look at the medical problems related to obesity.
You talk about those medical problems. There are certainly health consequences beyond just being big.
Absolutely. And that's really the burden that our society has now. So things like diabetes, cardiovascular disease, sleep disturbances, and a whole slew of other medical problems are related to weight and obesity. So it's not just a weight problem, but it's a significant medical burden.
And when we look at people that are obese, we see different sizes and shapes. It's where the fat is located that's just as important as having the fat.
Absolutely. So depending on where the fat is, it's related to different types of medical problems. So fat in the torso and the chest and the abdominal area tends to be more sinister than peripheral fat. The fat around the torso and the chest tends to be related with heart disease and more significant problems that can impact people's lives in terms of overall quality of health as well.
At the same time, we don't want somebody who's watching right now to say, well, my fat's elsewhere, I'm okay.
Absolutely. All fat in severe quantities is related to significant medical disease and burden. Just different types of fat are related to different types of medical diseases.
And it's not just the physical anomalies we worry about, but there's an economic impact here too. Suddenly you're paying more for everything that you have to do. There are impacts down the line because of your size and your bulk.
Significantly. And those range from social disturbances and personal disturbances, but as a surgeon and a physician, we're really looking at the medical burden of this. Chronic long-term disease, both in terms of mortality and morbidity, things like diabetes, ischemic heart disease, mm-hmm. high blood pressure, are all related to obesity.
When you talk amongst yourselves as doctors, are you afraid for the country, where we're going right now?
I think so, but we have a whole slew of physicians, both at the Cleveland Clinic and elsewhere, looking at this in a deeper level. So at all levels, both preventive and kind of end-stage intervention, I think we're addressing the problem.
Talk to me about the future. 20 years down the line, do you see us having turned the corner, or do you see it getting worse? And what are the consequences of each?
Well, the consequences are significant. I think that we have a more sophisticated understanding of what goes into severe obesity and the medical problems with it, but we're going to need a multi-pronged approach to effectively deal with this problem.
Mm-hmm. And if we don't do it, you're saying that's terrible, but if we do, can we turn the corner?
I think we can. I think that chronic diseases like diabetes and heart disease related to obesity, we're understanding the mechanisms with them and also the interventions that are going to circumvent those problems.
Okay. Dr. Matthew Crowe of the Cleveland Clinic, thank you for coming in.
Thank you.